Protecting your opponent is arguably wrestling's most sacred rule. However, not every wrestler has figured this out. Join us now as Wrestlelamia looks at wrestling's most unsafe performers. Keep in mind that we aren't chronicling wrestlers who shot on opponents, intentionally trying to hurt them.
If I want them to die, I ain't got no love for Vic, none, cause he's a idiot.
But wrestlers whose carelessness earned them a spot on wrestling's wall of shame for not protecting their opponents, this being backed up by other wrestlers. But before we go into the list, be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell for daily wrestling videos.
So if these stupid people have a problem with that, I don't care.
Number 1, Mabel. Big Man Mabel, aka Nelson Frazier, had something going for him back in 1995, and it wasn't wrestling ability, but his massive size and weight. Mabel's sheer size was enough to convince Vince McMahon that the former babyface from the tag team Men on a Mission could turn into a monster heel. In McMahon's defense, the WWF was struggling with its business, and although WCW hadn't started its NWO-driven domination just yet, things were looking pretty bad. Thus, Mabel turned heel, feuding with Diesel and The Undertaker. It quickly became clear that the 500-pound Mabel was an accident waiting to happen when he performed a leg drop on The Undertaker, accidentally landing on Taker's face and breaking an orbital bone in the process. Taker was shelved for some time and was forced to wear a protective mask when he resumed his program with Mabel. Mabel also reportedly injured Diesel during another match, and by 1996, Mabel was gone from the WWF.
And what he did was he just would stand over the guy and kick his legs out, and his ass would land in your lower back. I told him, don't do that to me. And he did it.
He would return with more seasoning under his belt and became a WWF regular as Viscera and Big Daddy V.
800 pounds of hostility!
Number 2, Goldberg. Fans have to look no further than 2019 Super Showdown match between Goldberg and The Undertaker to see Bill botching moves with reckless abandon. In hindsight, it's a miracle that Goldberg didn't seriously injure The Undertaker that night, as bumbling Bill, who according to some stories concussed himself before the match when he performed his pre-match ritual of headbutting the dressing room door, dropped Taker right on his head.
No way Goldberg's gonna be able to do this to The Undertaker!
No way!
Oh my God!
As bad as that match was, it pales to the career-ending injury Goldberg inflicted on Bret Hart when he botched a kick, concussing Hart right out of the wrestling business. Although Goldberg has repeatedly expressed remorse, Bret Hart still seems bitter over Goldberg ending his career and frequently brings this up during interviews.
To me, he was one of the most unprofessional wrestlers there ever was in the business. He hurt everybody he worked with. He might as well wrestle a real gorilla.
Number 3, Ryback. The big guy might as well be known as the botch guy, at least by CM Punk, who repeatedly claimed Ryback was dangerous to work with, going so far as to claim Ryback took 20 years off my life and that the wrestler intentionally broke his ribs.
You've done it so many times now. You either tell me right now you're dumb as f*** and you suck, or you did it on purpose. And he was like, I'm dumb as f***.
Now, Punk wasn't the only wrestler Ryback reportedly injured. In 2012, he injured Tensai, aka Albert, when Ryback screwed up his finisher, the Shell Shock. Ryback also reportedly concussed Dolph Ziggler with a stiff clothesline, earning him a reputation as a stiff and potentially dangerous competitor. Ryback was sometimes described as a poor man's Goldberg, but it's clear Ryback was up there with number 4, Vader. Big Man Leon White was one of the most agile wrestlers of his day, despite weighing in at over 400 pounds. Vader performed moonsaults equally as well, he pummeled opponents as one of the best brawlers of his era. The problem in Vader's case seems to be the big man just didn't know his own strength, and he was infamous for potatoing opponents, knocking out teeth and concussing wrestlers with an ill-timed blow. Vader's reputation grew so bad that several main event performers refused to work programs with him due to his string of legit injuries to opponents. Hulk Hogan refused to work a long program with Vader, and Bret Hart passed on one as well. Wrestling lore has it that Shawn Michaels quickly grew tired of Vader's heavy hands and killed his push in the WWF.
When did you guys officially change course?
Probably took a while for, you know, either Shawn being in Vince's ear constantly or just, you know, looking at him and wanting to see what he wanted to see.
Ironically, Vader would be injured by another unsafe wrestler who we're about to discuss next. As number 5, Stan Hansen. WWE Hall of Famer Stan Hansen was one of the most successful American wrestlers to compete in Japan, and while he enjoyed fame in North America, it was in Japan where he became a living legend. Unfortunately for Hansen's opponents, the big man was blind as a bat without his glasses, and he was well known for accidentally injuring opponents. One of these opponents was Vader, who Hansen accidentally thumbed in the eye, popping Vader's eye right out of the socket. The two men somehow finished the match, with it ending in a no contest, with Vader popping his eye back into his socket. However, that wasn't Hansen's first major injury to an opponent. On 26th April 1976, the young Stan Hansen battled WWF champion Bruno Sammartino at Madison Square Garden. About 8 minutes into the match, Hansen hit a lariat on Bruno, then followed up with a body slam. In what could have been a tragedy, Hansen bungled a body slam, dropping Bruno on his neck and breaking Sammartino's neck.
Felt really, really horrible too. I mean, brought me in a sight unseen, right? And then I end up hurting him.
I said, we're big boys. We know what we got into. We got into wrestling. Wrestling is, we like it, but it's a dangerous thing. Please, I said, think nothing of it.
Doctors reportedly told Bruno he came close to being paralyzed, but that didn't stop promoter Vince McMahon Sr. from asking the still injured Sammartino to wrestle Hansen just 2 months later. Sammartino's 1976 showdown at Shea Stadium show wasn't doing well at the box office, and McMahon needed a marquee match to save the WWF. Sammartino worked in the match, saving the promotion in the process. Number 6, the Steiner Brothers. Scott and Rick Steiner were one of the best tag teams of the 90s, but they were also one of the stiffest, pounding down opponents and leading to claims that the Burley Brothers wrestled recklessly, making life difficult and in some cases dangerous for opponents.
They would just suplex you on your head, you f***ing gave up. I mean, you know, Rodney and Scotty are two of the toughest f***ing on the planet.
I just seen my name on the chalkboard against the Steiners, and I momentarily contemplated quitting the wrestling business.
Wrestling lore has it that the Steiners were particularly brutal with enhancement talent, taking liberties with opponents with no backstage clout to seek redress.
Yeah, when we get in a ring with those guys, a lot of them, man, they just, you know, they're getting their money and they really didn't care. So we had to force some of them to do some of the stuff, you know.
One time this thing goes down and Robbie sticks a pencil up this guy's ass. And I looked at him and I said, do you know that's a felony, that's sodomy.
Rick Steiner would nearly end Buff Bagwell's career when Steiner botched his diving bulldog finisher, breaking Bagwell's neck. Number 7, Mr. Kennedy. Wrestler Ken Kennedy seemed to be on the fast track to success, winning the Money in the Bank contract at WrestleMania 23, and later seemingly on his way to being revealed as Mr. McMahon's long-lost storyline son. Despite these glimpses of greatness, Kennedy was ultimately future-endeavored from the WWE in 2009, with fans wondering what exactly happened.
Unfortunately, he would either get injured or something would happen, whether it be behind the scenes or in the ring, whatever it is, that would prevent him from getting to that next step.
After Kennedy's departure, he would claim that backstage politics had deep-sixed his career.
I had come out publicly and said stuff about, I should have never opened my mouth about the Chris Benoit thing.
However, according to some accounts, main eventers Randy Orton and John Cena both complained to Vince McMahon that Kennedy was unsafe in the ring. Complaints which might have been the driving force behind Kennedy's dismissal. Number 8, Ahmed Johnson. Like Mr. Kennedy, wrestler Ahmed Johnson seemed to be on the fast track to success, becoming the first African-American wrestler to win the Intercontinental Championship and finding himself in some high-profile feuds.
You have my respect, but last week, you crossed my end zone.
Nevertheless, Johnson found himself getting heat from opponents, including Farouk, aka Ron Simmons, and Owen Hart. Johnson injured Farouk at WrestleMania 13, hurting the future APA muscle man by breaking his ribs and puncturing a lung. As for Owen, Johnson's alleged clumsiness led to minor injuries, as well as at least one concussion.
Oh, he was injury prone, because of his own stupidity. He would hurt himself trying to do other people's stuff.
Johnson's career seemed to hit the wall, leading to speculation that his reputation as a careless opponent sent him out of the door. Number 9, Nia Jax. Nia Jax's WWE career may be defined by how the injury she inflicted on Becky Lynch arguably led to Becky's career taking off like a rocket. Back in 2018, Jax potatoed Becky during a brawl, fracturing Lynch's face and knocking her out in a match against Ronda Rousey at that year's Survivor Series. This turned out to be a blessing in disguise, as Lynch would likely have counted the lights for Rousey and faded from the event. Instead, Lynch's injury led to the fans rallying behind her, and Lynch scoring a big win at WrestleMania 35 against Rousey and Charlotte Flair. That's not the first time Jax has injured a star either. The large and powerful superstar sidelined Bayley back in 2017.
Yeah, but Booker, she has a lot to prove.
Oh my lord!
With fans arguing this put a stop to a potential Bayley vs. Alexa Bliss match that very year. And number 10, Alberto Del Rio. Alberto Del Rio found success in the WWE, but he also found controversy, leaving the company under heated circumstances on not one, but two separate occasions.
I'm not an aggressive person, but I mean, if you try to humiliate me, to make fun of me, of course I'm gonna fight back.
While Del Rio is a talented wrestler, he has hurt opponents on several occasions, leading to some fans claiming he's somewhat dangerous to work against in the ring. On one occasion, Del Rio concussed Christian, a concussion that proved one too many for Captain Charisma, forcing his retirement.
Time obviously a little upset and a little mad at him, but also in a way I kind of have to thank him in a strange way because I got to go home and sit back and reflect.
Del Rio accidentally knocked Daniel Bryan out, with unanswered questions as to whether this caused Bryan's temporary retirement due to concussions. There are also some questionable cases, some that need to be cleared up. Is number 1, AJ Styles. In AJ Styles' case, there is no denying that his finisher, the Styles Clash, has injured several opponents. In fact, we recently covered this in a video. In Styles' defense, the injuries were caused when opponents took his finisher the wrong way, resulting in their injuries. The argument can be made that it's not Styles who has injured his opponents, but the opponents themselves who botched it. At the same time, the argument can be made that Styles should retire the move, given the number of opponents who have been hurt. What do you think of this controversial conundrum? Let us know your comments down below. Number 2, Seth Rollins. Raw's Monday Night Messiah has a cool looking move with the buckle bomb, but it's also one that's injured two top opponents, and in one case, forced one to retire. Finn Balor was injured when he battled Rollins for the Universal Championship, while Sting was forced to retire after receiving one. Like Styles, Rollins' opponents botched the finisher, not him. So once again, the argument can be made that it's on the wrestler's opponent. And number 3, The Undertaker. The Undertaker has been wrestling since the 1980s, yet he's been involved in some high-profile injuries, the first being a tombstone piledriver that Hulk Hogan claims permanently damaged his neck. In 1998, The Undertaker battled Shawn Michaels at the 1998 Royal Rumble, with the Heartbreak Kid suffering what was thought to be a career-ending injury. Michaels took a back body drop and landed wrong, seriously injuring his back, although he was able to finish the match and drop the WWF Championship to Stone Cold Steve Austin at WrestleMania 14. The injury to Michaels wasn't Taker's fault, but what about Hogan?
He didn't know if he'd hurt him or not, and I don't think that anybody really knew at that point. However, in later years, once he got to see the tape and saw that, you know, hey man, I took good care of you.
Is that enough to qualify Taker as an unsafe opponent? Let us know in the comments down below, subscribe if you haven't already, follow us on Instagram and Twitter, and I'll see you next time with some more wrestling content.